third and last day of PDAC 2023 in Toronto. We are here in the offices of Laramide Resources, an interesting uranium development company, if I think that's the correct description. And we're here with Marc Henderson, the CEO. And first of all, to start us off, he's going to tell us in 45 seconds what is special about his company.
Thanks for the opportunity, Bjorn. Nice to be with you here today. I think what's special about our company is we're one of the very few companies left that are in the uranium development space. The sector has been reduced to probably about 20 companies that are probably the future suppliers of note that will be required to meet the what's now acknowledged to be quite a large deficit in the future because nuclear power is making a very big comeback. As you probably know, I mean, I know you're in Europe, but really it's a global problem we have in energy. And I think nuclear power is really in the conversation again, both because of the energy transition, because of the net zero initiatives everywhere, and obviously because it's really should be one of your first choices when you look to make large scale electricity.
Okay, so that's the opportunity there. That's actually, I wanted to talk to you about this a bit more because the narrative has been there for a while now that the demand is going to pick up, that the market is going to be stronger. Can you give us an idea what prices are needed to get the industry going as a whole, or get development companies getting into production? I mean, there's also the difference between spot and long-term prices. Perhaps you can say a few words on that.
Sure. I mean, that's very much the question, and we hear a lot of talk about what is referred to as the incentive pricing. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's sort of a mythical corporate finance kind of construct, to be honest. At the end of the day, at some point, the utilities will get aggressive enough that the price, it'll be bid up to a level where the projects that really have, you know, the scale and the margin will start to migrate online. That really has started to happen in some sense. Because this deficit, as I mentioned, has been there for a while, and you're starting to see the first tentative steps towards filling that. You've got two or three effectively big restart projects that are underway in the space, and I think there's the next suite of companies like ourselves that are going to be the next people to come into the marketplace. The marketplace is really dominated by two very large scale producers, Kazatomprom, which is really a nation state producer, but has many mines, and Cameco, of course, the largest public company. In terms of the spot and the term price, as you were asking about, I mean, unfortunately, the thing that the investors fixate on is the spot price, and it's the thing where you can get some kind of indication on a, you know, relatively, if not a daily basis, certainly a near-term basis. And then what really drives the market is the term price. And that's the nature of these contracts, typically done over periods of time, anywhere from, I'm going to say, 2 to 3 years out to 10 years.
Okay.
With utilities and actual producers. I mean, these companies, they don't want to vertically integrate, but they need visibility on where the supply is coming from. And you know, in other industries like lithium that's emerging, these would be referred to as offtakes.
Yes.
And you have a similar thing in uranium where really, but all the contracts are effectively bespoke contracts. And you do get pricing disclosure after a period of time that comes onto the marketplace. And that tends to be reported by various trade organizations and things like that, but it tends to be a lagging thing. But generally speaking, historically over probably the duration of the civilian nuclear, it's the term price is generally traded at a premium to the spot price.
Okay, so great to know, and we certainly hope that Laramide is going to be one of the companies coming onto the market then in a bit. But actually, we have quite a lot of projects, perhaps a bit much to talk about in the scope of this interview. So I would like to focus on the U.S. Church Rock and Westmoreland in Australia. Perhaps to start with the U.S., what kind of project is Church Rock? Could you give us a short summary?
Of course, yeah. I mean, let me just start with the whole asset base. As you mentioned, we sort of have five discrete assets. Some of the smaller ones are interesting. And then we also, which is a bit unusual, is we have these development stage assets, but we also have quite a very large, very interesting greenfield exploration thing, which people get excited. I mean, there is lots of funding going on in uranium out in Saskatchewan and places like that. What distinguishes us from the other developers actually is the fact that we do have two big, large development assets, both of which are each about 50 million pounds.
Okay.
The New Mexico asset, Church Rock, is what's known as an ISR, in situ recovery operation, or will be an operation. It's effectively, you're mining water, and really, you're mining in solution, bringing the solution to the surface and extracting the uranium once it's on surface. Very much different than the one in Australia, which is more what you think of as a conventional mine, you know, with a
with the trucks
moving around and a mill and all this kind of thing. So yeah, the one in New Mexico, very large legacy asset. We were the royalty holder. We bought out the owner. It was originally found by a division of General Electric, if you can believe that, back in the very late 70s.
Okay.
You know, very good grade. You know, it's got scale. Really relatively low technical risk. I would say all the Australian projects do well, is, you know, in the realm of technical risk and mining. That's also because of the nature of it. You know, relatively simple operation with, you know, not tricky metallurgy or any of these kind of things that are, you know, the things you look out for in mining operations that can cause you some consternation. But, you know, these are both very high quality, low cost curve, low technical risk projects. Then they matter to the industry potentially, because when you have some scale, the scale is kind of the thing that the buyers on the other side of the table are looking for, in terms of both, you know, your ability to deliver in, which obviously matters depending on where you are on the cost curve, but also sort of the scale that you can deliver in at, because it's an awful hard, if you've got a utility and you need to buy millions and millions of pounds every year, you kind of don't want to buy it, and if you can help it, in increments of 50,000 pounds.
Okay. Yeah. So very interesting. Now we're talking about development stage. What will it take to get these projects into production? What is still missing, and what can we expect over the next couple of months in that direction?
Yeah, so the sequence of events on our project in New Mexico, to start with, is we're delivering an economic study into the marketplace in the next 30 to 60 days, hopefully. We've engaged the consulting group, which is the same group that did our resource calculation. They're also the same group, it's called SLR, they used to be called Roscoe Postal. They did the studies at both Fission and NextGen, which are very familiar projects to those of you that follow the uranium space. So obviously they have expertise in that area. In terms of technical things we need to do, we need one final permit from the state of New Mexico.
Okay.
Some of the work we've done, we've recently drilled some holes. We need basically to demonstrate that we can successfully restore the aquifer as part of the final thing before they give you the final permit. We have all of our federal permits, if you will, which comes from an organization called the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and those are all in place and ready to go. So we're really down to the last permit. This is a process that'll take probably 2 years, and then we hope to be shovel ready in the United States.
And then you have to go for the financing.
Well, then you build it and all the rest of it. And it's actually the cost in terms of what we're looking at in the next 2 years. It's more time than money right now for us, in terms of once we get into this final stage of the permitting. And the nature of these operations, these ISR operations, they're actually, as I said, low technical risk. You're essentially drilling a well field. And so compared to the timeline that you would expect to take on anything that resembles a conventional mine, whether it's an open pit or an underground mine, the timeline is very much shortened because of the nature of what you're doing. Mm.
So sort of like if you're drilling a lithium hard rock or a lithium brine project, where you have the same, when you're drilling the brine, you need a few holes to show the principle, and then you can go. Not the same, of course.
Yeah, I mean, I'm no lithium expert, but I do. It's a very interesting sort of comparative, because, I mean, one of the things I think with these brines is you're basically kind of letting Mother Nature do the work on the processing when you put it whatever they do to dry it all out, a pond, and, you know, as opposed to kind of forcing the same chemical reaction through a plant, which I guess is what they're doing with some of the other hard rock things. And so that, I mean, I find that lithium space very interesting space. Now, it's very interesting compared to uranium as well, because it has many of the same characteristics, and a lot of it is being driven towards many of the same goals when you think about it, in terms of, you know, let's create greener energy going forward.
Okay. Well, yes, of course, that's part of the narrative too. Of course, there's different opinions, but generally speaking, when you have the plant up and running and using the uranium, of course, the pollution is at a minimum. But we're digressing. We need to get back to the Australian project. what's going to happen there over the next couple of months? What's the way?
The Australian project is really waiting for buy-in from the current state government, and it's in one of the political parties that really doesn't like uranium, but they've been very long tenured government. It's kind of a two-party system. We think certainly when we get the other member of the two-party club and they're in power again, then the permitting will be obviously relatively easy. I think Australia, once you get political buy-in, your timeline to production vis-a-vis somewhere like Canada, where I know there's a lot of angst, and you've listened probably around the PDAC, if you've been here this week, there's lots of
talk about
permitting. What can the government of Canada do better? I mean, that's just, I mean, but the United States has its own set of issues. They're different issues in terms of permitting. The one thing on Australia, when you finally have buy-in and you're ready to go, there's a reason that these Aussie lithium plays got up and running in 2 or 3 or 4 years versus we're still talking about in Canada. Okay. So I do think once we get the political thing we need in Australia, this project that we have there will go very, very quickly. We really know everything we need to know about it technically. We don't need to know anything else. We really need to do a feasibility study at the end of the day there. Mm-hmm. Once we have a timeline where we're allowed to build it, you know, so that your costs are the costs. And then it really goes, and it's a project of scale. It's a typical open pit type project. Provenance was a Rio Tinto project that we were able to get our hands on. It's a project of, you know, significance in the space, and it will be a very big, very attractive project when it comes. The last number on it, and again, there's lots of talk now about CapEx inflation and everything else, but the last number on it was in the order of about $300 million of CapEx to build a 4 to 5 million pound a year uranium project.
Okay. So very interesting. Still a lot of work to do still, but a way forward is clearly seen, I think. So to sum things up, could you give us just like, in your personal opinion, why is now a good time to have a close look at your company at Laramide?
Well, I think it's actually a great time in terms of where the market is, because I think the uranium companies as a group are super highly correlated, because this group of developers is all kind of trying to achieve one, the same mission, if you will. The uranium price came off a long, long bear market bottom. It was 10 years. We were grinding around $25, $30. Mm. There was a lot of excitement when it kind of took off the bottom. The uranium price didn't really triple. It almost tripled. All of the equities tripled. Okay. The peak was about November 21. We were a dollar then, I think. We tripled off the bottom, as it had all the others. Most of everybody has fallen in half, and we've been through sort of what I would say is about a 15-month corrective phase, if you will, in the markets. Mm-hmm. for that commodity. And I think everybody knows there's going to be a next leg at some point, because we're not even at the incentive price. So the question is, when the next leg happens, where does it go? And so I think in terms of coming in at a price when you know you're coming in, you're a long way through the corrective phase, and the price is quite attractive relative to where it was before.